Thank you, Lester. I had ample time to prepare this, so please excuse me already for some improvisations. I would like to understand whom is my audience, because you're mostly working or studying at the university here in Delft, but what department? So is there a neurosciences department, and who is from that? You are. Okay, yeah. Neurotechnology? No. Yeah. Okay. Well, thanks. I said my name is Lucas Evers. I work for Waag Society. That's a place in Amsterdam, in an old city gate, the Waag. And what we do is we combine art, technology, science, and the public, in order to look at emerging technologies and how to understand them as fair, open, and inclusive. That's our driving goal there. And we did that in the past with the internet. We started a project called the Digital City, which was at the beginning of the internet, when the internet was black. We created a big web page that represented the Amsterdam city, and it meant for democratization of the internet. It was quite a meaningful project, and we also did that with mobile technology. We do that also with certain scientific teams like biosciences and also neurosciences and neurotechnology. Hence, we started a project years ago called Hack the Brain, where we invited everybody who was interested to come to Waag Society and to try to hack the brain. Well, can you do so? After that, we approached a number of other partners in Europe. You see them here below. It's a hospital in Rome, Santa Lucia. It's an arts organization in Portugal and in Brussels, Art Share. Also, Technical University Delft, a partner in Prague that has a long-standing history in the combination of art and science, Tesseract, and Science Gallery Dublin, and we also have a partner that has a neurosciences and neurotechnology department at Tallinn University in Estonia. Quickly, something about Waag Society. We're organized in a number of labs, crossing a number of, covering a number of areas, the internet, cultural heritage and digitized cultural heritage, new forms of learning and education combined with maker spaces, fab labs, etc. We have a creative care lab where neurology and neurotechnology applications are also on the radar. I started the Open Wet Lab, where we also work with biosciences, life sciences, etc. We're housed in the Waag building that has an ancient anatomical theater, for those of you who don't know that, where this painting was made, a painting by Rembrandt van Rijn, who was painting the surgeons, the early medical sciences that happened in that space, dissecting a corpse of a criminal. So it's a very early art-science collaboration. We have laboratories, like said, we have workshops, exhibitions, performances, and we have a number of different methodologies to bring those different fields of expertise, and we also regard the general public as having in expertise together. We do that with something called critical making, users as designers, but also something more commonly known as hackathons, where people are 3 days long working on a theme. And there's different sorts of outputs. We produce a telephone, we create policy documents, we create arts installations and artistic residencies, and we create new forms of education. Now, What do we do in Brain Hack? Like I said, we bring the arts, neurosciences, neurotechnology together there, based on a number of assumptions. We are convinced that if you bring those people together and put them in a pressure cooker, there's interesting things coming out. There's also things that are lesser obvious and maybe even problematic. People define a theme, define what they want. Do they want to make a visualization? What is happening in your brain? Do they want to make a new medical application or non-clinical application, understanding how with neurotechnology you can understand how your work focus is distributed over an amount of time, etc. Sorts of applications that you can imagine to appear in such a context. We've organized a number of those events, always with the aim of trying to bring those different forms of expertise together to understand whether there is an added value there. And we are convinced of the fact that if you make artists work with neuroscientists and neurotechnologists, there are certain ethical problems of working with brain technology brought to the table in another matter. If you do that in a scientific context, you're always bound to research, ethics, etc. And artists, well, they're free people, they say, I don't care about that. So they say, okay, I want probes in my brain. I'm exaggerating, but having probes in your brain, that's not possible, or only possible under very experimental circumstances. You have, and not so much in Europe, but you have it in the US much more, it's called brain hacking, where people actually do so. So they do put probes of all sorts of kinds under their skin, under their the skin on their skull, etc., for aesthetic reasons, but also for experimental and for the reasons of the cool, let's say. And that is a context that goes into the ethics of working with brain technology in a very different manner and brings things to the table that can be of value if you are looking at how brain technology is emerging, how it's affecting, for instance, privacy issues, etc. Now, so it's about bringing this interdisciplinary groups of artists and scientists together. We organized these events since a few years. It's been picked up by other organizations. Sometimes we have colleague events happening at different locations. Like I said, it's to investigate if and how this group develops new insights that are relevant also in the frame of EU policies, and by encouraging the creation of social reflection, commercial prototypes, artistic installations. These sorts of things are quite much in development, together with Professor Sabine Rooser and Dr. Veronica Alfano, here of Technical University Delft. We've written a paper about how the ethics again, are brought differently to the table if you make those types of groups work together. And of course, also you already see here a very interesting image of an artwork. It's an artwork of Karen Lancel and Herman Maat. It's called EEG Kiss. And what it actually does is visualizing two artists kissing, and it's a very much appreciated image by the scientists they work with, but at the same time, although the image produced here is very powerful, you can also question, like, what are they producing? Are they producing neuro information on the graphs you see behind, or is it just their jaws working when they're kissing? It's interesting also to see in our hackathons where we work with artists that it's quite a difficulty for the artists to understand how those headsets work, and that in fact the signals they pick up are relatively I don't know how to give the right term for that, but superficial signals, and they have quite some interference. If you see them kissing, it might as well be the muscle workings that are causing the visualization, instead of the brain activity itself. But still, this is I think, quite a telling image that the collaboration of two artists or the collaboration of two people kissing creates a neurological interference that that you see here. Of course, we work with those hackathons with a further goal. It's not only to see what happens if people work in those hackathons together, but it's also to see whether those collaborations between the arts and sciences create longer lasting collaborations. We call those so-called spinal projects, and I will say some more about them later. Here, we selected a number of spinal projects. From the hackathons that happened, second brain, bisensorial brain dance, and brain worm, and PsySim is a work by a fashion designer of origin, Jennifer Canary Nikolova, who is researching and creating psychosis simulation tools. It's not directly using neurosciences or neurotechnology in this framework of working with BCIs, so we're not sure what to do with her. However, the work of art is very interesting, what she makes. And it's not only a work of art there. You see a picture here of two dancers that, maybe it's not the best picture chosen, but it's a picture where they also wear headsets. And with those headsets, they dance and they create a visualization that they influence by their brain activity during the dance. Doing so, they use a very simple, there you have Martijn, welcome. They use a very simple headset called the Muse, and the information gathered from that and transferred live to the artistic visualization on stage is not very accurate. So what we're going to do for the next step is make them work with more accurate headsets, also with more accurate open source headsets, like the headset that's working with infrared. It's called Open Nears. It's developed at the University of Berlin, and they're happy to work with us. But in order to create more understanding for the dancers, to know what they do in order to create that interaction with the visualization they create live on stage. Let's see where I have those other things. Yeah, this is something I'm going to say something last about. The other project is actually a very artistic project called Brainworm. You see it here. It was developed by two artists during our hackathon that we organized in Prague. And what they made they also used a BCI set that was brought to us by GTEC from the University of Graz, that is sponsoring all our events. And those headsets, in this case, are used to operate a pneumatic system that is blowing up car tires that are interwoven in such a way that they make that black worm that you see there move, however, really slowly, because the valves were not developed so well over the course of those 3 days that the worm was indeed moving. We gave them the first prize of the hackathon because it was not so much for the innovation in the interface between the workings of the brain and an object or a visualization, but more because of the originality of that big object they were moving by someone's brain activity. So if you use other technology to make the worm move in another way, I think the effect of someone's brain activity and the movement of the worm will become more one-on-one. So we're working on that, and very curious what those outcomes are going to be. This is not, here you have the picture of brain dance. This is not a very clear picture that I chose in the end, but Second Brain is one of the other winning projects of our hackathon in Amsterdam that we did last summer, where people try to make a connection between the fact that we have more understanding of our gut microbiome and its effects on our consciousness and an EEG set. I think they didn't succeed so much in doing so, but their research questions were so interesting because they involved the understanding of the brain and the workings of the brain, something that is not so much isolated, and that it's also influenced by a lot of other outside influences. That led them to work with a project that is happening at the University of the Free University of Amsterdam, where they will collaborate with Nienke van Atteveld, who is a brain scientist there and has an ERC grant, where she invited the artists of this project to work with her on a brain visualization, where it seems to be proven that if you can visualize the plasticity of the brain, the fact the brain is not a how should I say in English? I'm not a scientist in the end, but the brain is something that is very dynamic, that is changing all the time, and if you visualize that, it seems to have a positive effect back on the plasticity of the brain. So Nienke van Atteveld is using that assumption in her research about neurosciences and education. And she wants a number of artists on her team to help her create such a visualization that will be interactive and made with school children. Bisensorial was the winner of the first prize. They will publish this project under another title in Leonardo Journal shortly. And what they did was try to make a connection between the brain and the way we are conscious of our body. They are making a kind of wearable that is pointing at different points in the spine in order to adjust and make you more conscious of your body. And there, the team was a team from Cognovo, which is a public-private and creative group of PhD students at Plymouth University that came for the hackathon to Amsterdam, and they're making a prototype of this now. So, with this, I hope to have given you a little bit of an idea of what we try to do with those hackathons, trying to bring creatives, artists, hackers, and scientists together, which will, in the end, lead to a manifesto we are creating together with all the partners in the project, called the Manifesto of Neuroartistic Technologies, which is about gathering creative approaches of neurotechnology, creating with neurotechnology, probing, so also looking at the ethics, looking at societal impacts, mentoring of the collaborations, and fostering of the collaborations. So if you want to follow our project, I think there should be a link to our website. No, I can give you the link. The website is hackthebrain-hub.com, where you in the end will also find our manifesto. I now give the word to Martijn Arts, who is the boss.
Hello, everybody. Actually, for me, it's great to be here because I was a student industrial design engineering until 1997. So actually, this was my hometown for a long while, and it's a great town. So as long as I care, Hack the Brain. What is Hack the Brain? I'm going to tell you a little bit of a story, not about technology, but just about curiosity. Because that's what started the whole thing. And it started, by the way, 5 years ago. So my question actually was, when I sat down in a bar with Frank Rechin, all good things happen in a bar, by the way, what if we could connect without language and by hacking or uploading or sharing brains? Would we remain individuals? Or would we become more connected? And could we then solve insolvable problems? Because maybe everybody has a part of the solution. Could we become kind of like a joint organism? Well, of course, very vague, these questions. But to make it really practical, we said, okay, we shouldn't investigate. We shouldn't just study. We shouldn't just go to a university. We should just start to make a hackathon. Hack the brain. And those three words immediately attracted other people, artistic people, philosophers, but technologists and developers. They all wanted, even though they didn't know anything about it, they all wanted to be part of that. So that was like a long time ago. For the past 3 years, actually, now this Hack the Brain has grown into something not only Dutch, but also European and even international, also in America, in the States, in Canada, even in Israel. So people everywhere are hacking brains. And they also use the words hack the brain, which was cool. But this Hack the Brain thing was not about having solutions. It's about discovering stuff. And discovering stuff, in order to discover stuff, you need different people with different backgrounds. Only technologists are really solution-oriented. Only philosophers may want to just talk on. So we wanted to create some kind of mix. And that's why we created Hack the Brain. So then my question was actually, and it's very small on my screen, what will we see if we look inside a brain? And current technologies actually, they do exactly the same thing as all physics students and engineers. They study it based on the things they do. It's really biomechanical. They study cells. They study chemistry. They study, like everything it does. And that's what happens now. So, of course, the brain has some signals, and you can detect that in some way or another by electricity or by the oxygen level in the blood veins. But what you actually do is you look inside a brain that might be active in order to produce movement, biomechanical, or to produce something else. But of course, you might want to wonder, where is your memory? Where is your idea? Where are your ideas? And where does your character come from? Can you detect that? Can you not look into a brain as in biomechanical tissue, but can you also look into a mind? That was the basic question that we wanted to explore. Because, I mean, we're all functionalists here. You put something in, then there's a black box, and then there comes something out, and that's a biomechanical thing. But like in the days of Rembrandt, like really long time ago, when they did the anatomical lesson, they didn't know what was inside the body. And then they cut it open, and they discovered that a large part of the body is actually some kind of a robot. It's biomechanical stuff. If you have a muscle, you tension it, then your finger goes like that, and then there's a vein system that goes that transports fluids everywhere. So it's biomechanical. So that but for them to cut into a body, it was actually exploring the body because nobody knew what was in it. It was inside the body. Nobody was allowed to see because it was the area of God. It was something that you should not discover. Same thing is happening now. I mean, we are looking into a mind or a soul, and whenever you say that, everybody says, no, soul or a belief, it's the area of the God. And you cannot discover that, so we only should stick to what we know, so we should stick to the biomechanical workings of the brain. And that's what we actually wanted to do differently. We wanted to find, with these philosophers and these artists, we wanted to find different angles as to how can we discover the mind. And what will we see then? Of course, the first idea is, okay, then there's this solipsism kind of thing. So you look into a brain in order to find yourself. So there's a small person inside the brain, which is me. And my whole body is kind of a robot that is like directed by this little me in my brain. That's a normal analogy. Thank you. That's a normal analogy for the man inside your brain. And if you say that, then of course movies like Matrix and stuff happen because you don't have to have a body. You can just direct with your tiny me inside your brain. You can direct anything. You can maybe even steer the world if you just get it out. But of course, you will have the problem. It's like the being Malkovich thing. And you will have a problem. Who is inside the little man that's inside my little man inside my head? So actually, that's not really a way to go, but it's an interesting way to go. But what would happen if we just see things differently? Before Galileo, people thought that the world was flat, and then he said, well, it might also be round. And then everybody saw the whole universe in a different way. It was not that we all became more intelligent or that we all knew more. We just saw different things. And I believe that what happened back in the days of Rembrandt, when they saw that in the body there's all sorts of wonder and stuff, can happen now again. We only need to see things in a different way. And in order to see things in a different way, you need to be curious. And you need to take things from all perspectives, and you need to make people do stuff that they didn't do before together. And then what might happen then? Where will it lead us? I mean, these are just vague ideas. Of course, Kevin Kelly said that technology is actually the successor of mankind. So we are... I think he even mentioned us as the sexual reproduction organ of technology, which is weird. And it will succeed us, and we will be obsolete. I don't think so. And this other Hans Moverek, he is actually really a Carnegie Hall super, no, not Carnegie, Carnegie University super professor back in the days. And he thought, well, I think we can copy minds. We can copy a person into a web like the internet, and there it can evolve faster than it can evolve with their natural body. So he thought, there's a successor, but we remain human. How can that be? And then, of course, there's more recent movies like Transcendence. It is about transcendence. What is? But what does that mean? And there's, of course, this Jos de Mol, who's a philosopher, who thinks that humans are just a swarm of cells, and a brain is just a swarm of cells too. And it's an organism by itself that has, that is moving. But also a swarm of sparrows is one organism. Could a swarm of people be one organism? So it's, to us actually, doing Hack the Brain was about humans and technology. In order to find out what technology is, maybe, I thought, it's kind of interesting. Because humans actually always try to mimic themselves or nature. We try to make robots that look like humans. Why? Are they better if they look like humans? Why is that? And by the way, we compare brains to a motherboard of a computer. And we build cells with nanotechnology. And we see DNA as an information storage thing. And we even store books on DNA nowadays, because we know that it's far more efficient than a chip. So actually, this is kind of curious. I mean, we actually, technology is we are mimicking technology. So actually, if you look at technology then that would be the mirror reflection of what we see as ourselves. So everything around us, every technological artifact is just a mirror. It's a self-reflection. Well, technology seems to develop in similar traits as evolution does, because we are actually mimicking ourselves. Humans are always reflecting on themselves, and they extend and rebuild ourselves in technology. Technologies are collective self-image. It's not my self-image. It's a collective thing. I mean, I didn't invent technology. This is not my idea, by the way. Of course, I hoped it would be, but there's another philosopher, Martin Kolle, a Dutch philosopher, who really coined this similarity. And when you look at this hardware kind of technology, like robots, then you can also, of course, go to the more software kind of things. Maybe there we can find an answer. If the mirror reflection is what we see of ourselves, then maybe there, in the mirror, we can just see what a mind is. Could a mind just be a set of RAMs, processing units? And we are actually, there's lots of investigations as to how much processing can a cell do, and can a computer be faster if it's hybrid, so both cells combined with technology. And can you store information like on DNA, but also in a mind? And how can you put it in? How can you get it out? That was actually one of the first questions in the first Hack the Brain. How can we put stuff in the brain? And how can we get stuff out just by using an EEG? And there are, of course, really slow ideas about that. I mean, if you concentrate with your mind to move a ball, you can train certain aspects of your brain, and if you're, for instance, paralyzed, you can even train your hand by not moving your hand, by moving the ball. And whenever your arm is again mobile, because it's not in plaster, for instance, then by having all these experiments, after the plaster is off, you can more easily move your hand. So you can actually, by doing brain gymnastics, train other things than just your brain. Weird. So these are just vague ideas. So if the brain is also, it's not only about memory, the brain is also about perception. Because does your eye see things, or does your brain see things? And who is the leader of the both? I mean, there are experiments where they can see inside your cortex what letter that you can see. And there's even experiments where they see where they first let you look at a movie and then record all the states of your visual cortex, then let you see different fragments of like random YouTube movies, and they just select the ones that trigger a similarity. And if you just put all these fragments behind each other, you have the same movie. Cool. So you can see in the brain. It's like something there. And if that's true, can you then have an off switch to the brain? Is there an off switch? Of course, if the electrical signals are dead, but can you then put it on? Why not? If you just really understand what ideas are, of course your bio material will deteriorate really rapidly if there's no oxygen there, but maybe you can again jumpstart a brain. That's interesting. For me, that's interesting. I hope you like it too. But this is just pondering. And so. But then we are now only talking about individuals. First, individual selves, physically. Then individuals, software-like. And then, beyond the self, how about the network? Of course, you can now build a supercomputer by using all different computers. And then it works as one, and then it becomes a supercomputer. Well, there's more to it, but you can explain it like that. So we are connected. So if there is communication, like talking, this is the same as just having a protocol for data exchange. And of course, if you can talk simultaneously on different channels, which would be hard to understand, of course, could we then communicate faster? And this is actually also something that you can do if you just have something on your head. Actually, what we do all the time, because I'm not only talking, I am also moving my hands. I am signaling all kinds of other stuff than language only. But if you can connect brains, can you then make it even more so? And if you then connect everyone all together, what will happen? Would there be some kind of system there? Aren't we all a system already? Like Douglas Adam claims in The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, where they create the Earth as a computer. So these are questions. This is all about questions. So are we all, as connected humans, are we a swarm? And can we use technology to recreate us as a swarm? Because technology is our self-image. Could we use technology to evolve in new ways? And will it then be like Kevin Kelly says, it's the successor of us? Or is it just us merging with our self-image? It's just our reflection. Could we even augment humanity? Well, this is a system, of course. If a swarm organizes itself as something which is an integral whole, then it's a system. But aren't we, as people, aren't we a swarm of cells? Or what is different from a swarm of cells than a body? Well, just questions. Or, of course, you could say, well, a body without a heart is a dead body, so this is not a loosely coupled system. But is maybe an ant heap then a system? Questions. What we actually tried to do, and with several experiments we already did, by posing these questions and by asking it to different sorts of people who work in a multidisciplinary team, you get really cool new experiments. Some of them are nonsense or even bullshit, but they are new perspectives. And they might create an idea in someone else that create maybe a lesser bullshit idea. And by the way, maybe on hindsight, the idea wasn't so bullshit after all. Wasn't Galileo also a bullshitter? By some, by the way. So, well, actually, there were experiments by people connecting and doing stuff together. And actually, they could. And they could, by making their brain signals simultaneous, they could build a cathedral in a computer. And by doing that, afterwards, the team effort was also a good estimator for their team abilities. That was cool. So then what is the question? What is technology then? Well, there's all sorts of ideas about that. But I think it is not Kevin Kelly says. It's not the technium that succeeds us. It's augmented humanity. And you find really simple examples of that, actually. I mean, Deep Blue, for instance, the computer that can conquer anyone playing chess, playing Go, cooking meals, being creative. I mean, it can conquer anyone. But the fun thing is that ordinary standard chess players with ordinary standard chess computers together can beat Deep Blue anytime. And that's cool. So it's not about us and them. It's not about technology versus us. It's looking at technology, building it, using it, reflecting on it, seeing different angles. And I believe that it might be even technology that makes us human. And it might be that it helps us to reconnect with each other. Even reconnect with ourselves. And we might become more one than we can imagine. And shape our new reality. And that's just a different way of looking at the same thing. It's all about perspectives. I don't know who knows this book, but it's really a recommendation. It's by Edmund Abbott. It's a mathematician. And it's really easy to read, by the way. It's not a lot of pages, so you could do it. And it's all about imagining the fourth dimension. It's really cool. It's so simple. You only see it if you understand. And that's all about, that's why we do these things. It's to discover stuff. So is this the end? I don't know. For me, it's just an idea for a book that I call The Zen of Technology, which would be my debut. And this is Just Hack the Brain.